cyanotypes are really exciting for me, and I've just recently discovered how easy they are or how interesting they are to work with. It's a process that you can manipulate how you like depending on who you are and what actually interests you, and it's very simple. So it's a really good one to putting onto cloth and then working with that cloth to develop and make quilts or patchwork or textile art, but it's just something that's really interesting. Now, cyanotypes were invented in 1843 by an English scientist called John William Frederick Herschel, and Mr. Herschel was interested in all those early photographic processes, and he discovered when you mixed a couple of chemicals together, you created a mixture that was really sensitive to the sun's energy, and where it was exposed it got fixed and becomes a dark blue, and where it was unexposed, it was covered in something, it would wash out and reveal the white underneath. And so this blue and white image became a blueprint. Now, those two chemicals you can buy in bottles. You can buy the original crystals, salts, and mix them up yourself. But I tend to buy the mixed up bottles. They come in two parts, and one is called potassium ferricyanide, the other called ferric ammonium citrate. And they just have got elements in them with spare electrons that shift themselves around when they're mixed together to make this solution that is really energy sensitive. And you basically pour equal amounts of these two chemicals together, and small amount, because a small amount goes a long way, and you paint them onto the surface. Now we're going to actually paint the chemicals onto the surface of the paper or the material. And there's these two chemicals, part A and part B, which you can buy as a set. And you use a very small amount of each one, but equal parts. So I use the lid just to get the chemical into the pot, the same amount. So here we are, look. Just a lid full of part A, which here is the potassium ferricyanide, and a lid full of part B. Now, in an ideal world, you'd do this bit in the semi-dark, just in the evening with an ordinary bulb on would be all right, or in dark room conditions if you happen to have a dark room, but I'm demonstrating now so that we need a little bit of light. So I'm mixing those two up, and you can see there's just a small amount in there, and this is a sort of fine watercolour, maybe handmade paper, this here, a little bit like blotting paper, but I'm going to paint an area on here and then take it up to my airing cupboard to dry. Take it somewhere dark, just to dry over an hour or two until it's dry enough then and fixed enough on the paper to then take out into the sun. I use one of these spongy brushes, and I dip it in, and I basically paint over the surface of the paper, and I usually cover it with three coats. And if you wanted to make the edges very straight, you could use some masking tape or something like that, but I'm just doing it by hand here. And like I said, I'm going to, it's more or less going to have three coats, and I alternately go vertically, horizontally, and I think that will probably do. So it looks like this. I'll put that to one side on the floor in the more shaded area. Now I've got a piece of cotton fabric here, quite natural fabric, and I'm going to paint on that on the surface. Now fabric takes the chemicals up in different ways, and you'll just have to experiment. You know, some of the denser material seems to take up lots and lots of chemical, and some of the lighter fabric, like this one, the chemical seems to sit on the top nicely. I'll just show you that. So that's that. You can see that it's not gone all the way through, but pieces of sheet, it would absorb it very quickly and go through. And then maybe I ought to do a bigger one with, this is proper watercolour card, and I'll finish off the little bit that I've mixed here on the watercolour card. So take your sponge in fairly bold strokes. And that's the three layers that I've put on this watercolour card. I could have used a big brush like this, but that can get very full and swashy as you use it. But anyway, I'll take these up to the airing cupboard now and then leave them to dry, and the next stage will be then to expose them in the sun with different materials on top. And so while that's drying, I thought I would show you some of the materials that I might use to cover this, to make the start to make some of the images that I want. And there are different ways of doing it. Another word for a cyanotype is a blueprint. So blueprints come from placing a negative on top of the cyanotype base, on top of the emulsion cover. And the light will obviously come through the clear areas. But you can also, here's a moth I've drawn. This little moth is on tracing paper, and where it's black it will become white on the cyanotype, and where the tracing paper is, that will let the sun through. On a transparency like this, completely clear, you're drawing through the clear areas, it will definitely get fixed by the sun. So different materials, tracing paper is pretty good, transparency, or you could actually draw on some glass. But then there's the natural materials, like these flowers here, it's toothwort from the garden, quite a very common weed and enjoys my soil. So I've taken some of these and I'll use these in the cyanotype. But these other examples here, this one here is a moth that I've made from leaves, so a couple of sage leaves and a bit of this and that to create the moth image, very very simple way of doing that. Then these were some corn flowers that I placed on top of a piece of fabric. And this was using up some leftover ink, leftover chemicals here, and the mixture was painted around the edge. I've got different plant material there, and with that I could do all sorts of things, stitching, painting, quilting, make something quite abstract if I wanted to. So the next stage then is to take the painted surfaces that have been in the dark out into the light and place some of these things on top of it to see what I get. You have to leave them out in the light for about 10 minutes. So here I am now outside, and there's the plants on the watercolour card, and the sun is making the shadows across the image, and not much is actually fully resting on the surface. And this is the point when you can make a decision as to whether to cover the plants with a piece of glass or clear polycarbonate to press them down and fix them. I like to have that shadow and a range of different colours, if you like, in terms of what it might finish up like. So it's up to you. This is another cyanotype on a piece of cloth, and you can see the shadows the plants are casting. Not sure how it will work out, but I think this is worth a try. You can see that I've got a drawn moth on the surface as well, and this is an experiment. This is the small material piece that I made earlier. The flowers are casting shadows, and if I wanted a flatter image, I'd weigh it down with a piece of glass. I like the shadows though, so I need to wait 5 to 10 minutes, and then the background will go a bronze colour and be ready to be washed off, taken inside and washed off. I brought the piece of material in from outside, which had these flowers on it, and it's been outside for 5 or 10 minutes, and I've put it in this vat of water, and I'm ooly-ollying it around to try and get rid of any of the unfixed chemical and to take it off the surface of the material. You can see here it's coming through. Ideally it needs about 5 minutes in this water. Basically, I've shown you how to make a cyanotype on a piece of material and also on paper, and then you can take this and you can add to it. It might please you as it is, but you can then stitch or paint or print on top of here if you'd like to, and if you were making a quilt, you'd then be able to incorporate all sorts of designs. So world's your oyster in terms of what you might want to do with these cyanotypes.